Hi everyone, I'm back with a new video to practice filters and body diagrams. Today we'll solve some more exercises together on this topic. I'm Gio, an assistant professor at UPF in Barcelona and an expert in wireless communications. On this channel, I upload theory and tutorial classes on signals and systems, so if you want to learn the fundamentals of signals and systems, this is the right channel for you. Let's get started with today's exercises. The first one is about sketching the asymptotic approximations of the border diagrams of the magnitude of a certain frequency response h of j omega given as a fraction of polynomials in j omega. So let's get started with this. To begin with, we find it convenient to decompose the second order polynomials, both the one at the numerator and the one at the denominator, in terms of products of first order terms. So in order to do that, let's start with the numerator. Let's write it by taking out the factor 10. Now let's try to find the roots of the polynomial in square brackets. If we do these simple calculations, we find that both roots are identical and equal to minus 0.1. So what we have in the square brackets is actually a square, and we can simply write it as 10 times j omega plus 0.1 squared. Let's move on to the denominator. We do the same thing with the denominator. We look for the roots of the polynomial in j omega. And this time there are two different roots. So if you solve by using the formula, you find that one root is minus 10, the other one is minus 1. So that means that the denominator can be expressed as a product of two first order terms, j omega plus 10 times j omega plus 1. Right. So let's take note of that. Let's write that down at the top in red. We have now basically expressed h of j omega as the product of four factors. So we know that it's easier to work with each simple factor individually and then sum up their respective logarithmic diagram. So let's do that. We label them 1, 2, 3, 4 in light blue. We start with number 1. Number 1 is really easy. It's a constant factor 10, which contributes 20 dB flat constant. What about number 2? Number 2 is a second order term at the numerator. So if you calculate 20 log 10, the magnitude of that term, well, you obtain 20 log 10 of omega squared plus 0.01. Right, so we can approximate that because when omega is much larger than 0.1, then omega prevails, and we can approximate this with 40 log 10 omega. In the other case, when omega is much smaller, well, then we obtain minus 40 dB constant. So let's take note of this result that we have obtained for term 2, and then let's keep going with number 3. So number 3 is a first order term, but at the denominator. So if we use the usual approximation, we get that when omega is much larger than 10, this contributes with a negative slope of minus 20 dB per decade. And when omega is smaller than 10, then it's flat minus 20 dB. Let's write that down. And now let's proceed with the fourth and last term. So we have 20 log 10 of the magnitude of 1 over j omega plus 1. And so if we write the magnitude of this complex fraction, we have minus 20 log 10 of the square root of omega squared plus 1. Again, we can approximate this in the usual way. When omega is larger than 1, or much larger than 1 at least, then we get minus 20 log 10 of omega. And when omega is much smaller than 1, we get 0 dB. Right, we take note of this. Now we proceed with plotting. So let's start with the first term, which is constant 20 dB. So this is going to be a straight horizontal line. Okay, I represent this in green. Let's move on to the other ones. Number 2, I'll represent this in pink. Well, this is minus 40 dB flat up to 0.1. And then when omega is larger than 0.1, it grows by 40 dB per decade. So it looks like this, what you see in pink, okay? The third one, let's represent in another color, in purplish. So this one, up to omega equal to 10, is flat minus 20 dB, and then it goes down by 20 dB per decade. So it looks like this. And now the fourth one, in red, it's 0 dB for omega smaller than 1, and then it goes down by 20 dB per decade. So here it is. Now all I have to do is to sum up these four body diagrams to obtain the total one for h of j omega that I'm looking for. So let's do this little by little. Let's start with the first bit. So you see that up until 0.1, I have the contribution of four flat curves, 20, 0, minus 20, and minus 40. So if I sum them up, I get a constant straight line position at minus 40 dB, okay? Then I move on. For omega between 0.1 and 1, three of these curves are constant, but one of them grows by 40 dB per decade. So it contributes 40 dB per decade. And that is the result, okay? Then between 1 and 10, I still have the previous one that grows by 40 dB per decade, but now there's another one, the red one, that starts kicking in, which decreases by 20 dB per decade. So the net growth now is going to be plus 20 dB per decade. And finally, at omega equal 10, there's another decreasing slope by minus 20 dB per decade, which sums up with the previous ones, and therefore the final result is constant slope, zero. So here's the final diagram of H of j omega that we were looking for. Let's move on to the next exercise. In this case, well, it's pretty much the opposite. We have a diagram, a Bode diagram, and we need to determine a certain transfer function. In particular, we need to determine the transfer function of the inverse of this system, right? So we need to determine 1 over h j omega. But I find it very convenient to determine h of j omega first and then to simply write the inverse of that. So let's do that by observing the figure. So this is the magnitude of h of j omega in dB scale. We see that there is one term for sure that contributes by decreasing with a negative slope, and we see that the slope is minus 40 dB per decade, and this kicks in for omega equal 0.1, 10 to minus 1. Okay, so that means that we need a term like this, 1 over j omega plus 0.1 squared. Why is it square? It's because the slope is minus 40 dB per decade. And why is it j omega plus 0.1? Well, because it kicks in at omega equal 0.1, right? Then in the next interval, we have another term that kicks in at omega equal to 10 and reduces the slope from minus 40 to minus 20. That means that it contributes with a positive slope of plus 20. And it kicks in at omega equal 10. That means it's a term like this, j omega plus 10. So 10 because that's where its contribution starts. And it's a positive term of the first order because it contributes plus 20 dB per decade, okay? And then finally, from omega equal to 100 and onwards, we have another contribution by plus 20 dB per decade because the slope is now straightened. It goes from minus 20 to constant, okay? So that means that we need a term like this, j omega plus 100. Why 100? Because it kicks in at omega equal 100. And why is it at the numerator? Well, because it contributes 20 dB per decade, so it's of the first order. Then we might have a multiplying coefficient, A, which we need to determine. How to do that? Well, we observe that for very small frequencies, let's say for omega equal 0 or minus infinity in logarithmic scale, the value has to be 100 dB, okay? So let's do that. Let's set omega equals 0. Then what we get is 20 log 10 of A times 1 over 0.1 squared times 10 times 100. Okay, so if we just calculate this, and it's very simple, we get 20 log 10 of A times 10 to the power of 5. We want this to be equal to 100 dB. So for that to happen, we need basically 20 log 10 of A equal to 0, which means that we need A equal to 1. So we can just replace A equal to 1, and we have obtained the expression for H of j omega. But we were looking for the inverse of the system. So what we need to write is the reciprocal of that fraction, 1 over H of j omega, which we can simply write by inverting the fraction. And if we further develop the calculations, here's the final expression that we obtained. Great. So let's move on to the final exercise for today. Now we need to build a low pass filter with the following specifications, okay, in the frequency domain. It needs to have a certain cutoff frequency, it needs to have no ripple in the band pass, and it needs to have a certain suppression band, okay? Cool. So we're going to do this graphically because it's going to be very helpful. So let's start with the first fact, which is that the cutoff frequency has to be at 100 radians. Okay, so this is the first fact that we have. The second fact is there has to be no ripple at all in the bandpass. That means that the response has to be completely flat. So it looks like this, right? As in the figure. C, the suppression band has to be below minus 35 dB, okay, for omega larger than 1000 radians per second. That means that when omega grows by one decade, so from 100 to 1000 radians per second, I need to have a drop in the response by at least 35 dB. So this is what it means. It means that I need to go down by at least 35 dB from the initial value of my response. Cool. So for example, I can choose a slope of minus 40 dB per decade, and that will satisfy my requirements. I know this is convenient because I can realize that with a second order pole. All right. So what information do we have? Well, we know that the cutoff frequency is at 100. So the term we're looking for is in the form 1 over j omega plus 100, right? So 100 because of the cutoff frequency. And it's a squared term. It's of the second order because what we want to kick in at omega equal 100 is a slope of minus 40 dB per decade. All right. So we also have no other zeros or poles because we want the response to have no ripple at all in the band pass, right? So what we need to determine is maybe a multiplying coefficient A. How to choose that? Well, for example, if I choose the value in the band pass, then I set omega equals 0. I impose the value in the band pass, so the 20 log 10 of the magnitude of h of j omega for omega equals 0. Okay. For example, I set it to 0 dB. So if that's the case, if I want 0 dB, well, then A has to be 100 squared, so it has to be 10,000 or 10 to the power of 4. So if I just replace that, well, then I have obtained the transverse function that I was looking for, right? So in this video, we have solved three new exercises on both the diagrams and filters. Please keep watching the other exercise videos as well as my theory classes to better understand the fundamentals of signals and systems. And more videos on our key topics are also coming, so subscribe to this channel and you'll be the first one to know when I upload something new. See you in the next videos.